الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآت المال على حبه ذوي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائلين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآت الزكاة والموفون بعهدهم إذا عاهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون صدق الله العظيم. Honorable friends, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I begin with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, creator and provider, Rabbul Alameen. May His choicest peace, blessings and salutations be on our beloved Master Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May His pleasure and blessings be upon His beloved family, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his sahaba and sahabiyat, and all of those will follow them in their footsteps till the day of Qiyamah. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, I've selected an ayah for today's discussion. And this ayah is ayah number 177 from Surah Al-Baqarah. And it is known as Ayatul Birr, the ayah and verse which talks about good qualities and righteousness. The word birr, which I have used, which is used in the ayah, we translate it as righteousness, but in Arabic it is a much more comprehensive term. The word in Arabic, it refers to birr, refers to sidq, truthfulness, being true. It refers to taqwa, which we translate as piety. It translates as itqan, doing things with perfection. And also has ihsan, doing things with excellence. So doing things with perfection, excellence, being true, and having taqwa. And taqwa, we know, is one of the most used trait in the Quran. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you may acquire taqwa. وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, and fear me and have taqwa of me, O people of intellect. So taqwa we translate as consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our life, being cognizant of Allah Almighty in our life, and fearful of the adab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this is taqwa. Now, birr, the word which is going to be talked about in this ayah 177, entails all of those things. Now, you and I, we have a unique definition in our own circles for who is righteous, who is salih, who is a muttaqi, who has birr, who is righteous, who is pious. And we also have a definition for those who are contrary to that. We also have a definition for who is fasiq, fajir, transgressor, munafiq. Right? We have a definition for the right, and we have a definition for those who are contrary to it in our own understanding. Let us look at these definitions from the lens of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning it. So birr, which we've translated as righteousness, so many times we feel that if somebody conforms to my idea of religiosity, then that person is religious. That you can determine based maybe on his outer or her outer appearance. If his and her outer appearance conforms to my idea of being religious, then this person has taqwa. If somebody doesn't conform to it, they are, doomed. So this ayah, let me translate the beginning portion. And then I want us to delve into the background. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب. Righteousness and being pious and muttaqi and having taqwa, etc., is not defined and confined to you facing or directing your faces towards the east or towards the west. Whether you go in this direction to attain Allah or you go in that direction to achieve righteousness. Righteousness is not determined by the direction you're going to be directing your faces. What does this mean? It has a metaphorical meaning for today's discussion. A literal meaning of it, which I just given a translation. The context of this is the tahmil al-qibla, the changing of the qibla direction from Baytul Muqaddas, Masjid al-Aqsa, towards Masjid al-Haram. That's the context. In verse 144 in Surah Al-Baqarah onwards, the ayah talk of tahmil al-qibla, the changing of the direction of qibla. That is the context. We know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Sahaba, after migrating to Medina Munawwara, prayed the salah towards Masjid al-Aqsa for approximately 16 to 17 months. That remained as the first qibla of Islam. The people who were the Ahlul Kitab, Yahud, Nasara, etc., in Medina and the surroundings, used to also have a direction for salah. They used to also face Masjid al-Aqsa, Bayt al-Muqaddas. The Yahud used to face towards the western side. The Christians and Nasara used to face the eastern side. The Sahaba and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to face to the northern side of Jerusalem. The backs were towards Masjid al-Haram. When the change came through the ayat of the changing of direction, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ, ayah 144, Surah Al-Baqarah, you can check this ayat for reference. The Ahlul Kitab, the people who had their own directions towards the same, and the Mu'minun who were facing the same direction. A controversy arose after the change. The controversy arose, and some simple-minded Muslims also felt, with regards to the direction, what they were being hearing from the Ahlul Kitab, that righteousness is if you follow this direction. The Nasara were saying the only taqwa is if you do this way. The Yahud were saying this way. This created confusion. And similarly, many of those outer rituals which the people were doing ostentatiously, it created doubts in the minds and hearts of the early believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nullifies this whole discussion. That لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبْلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. This righteousness of those who are saying only if you follow this way, then you are people of taqwa. If you go that direction, if you go to this masjid, you are fine. If you go to that masjid, you are doomed. So metaphorically, it doesn't only refer to tahwil al-qibla. Metaphorically, it refers to today's, our day-to-day mu'amalat and the way we perceive others, or we perceive our deen, or schools of thought, madahib. This is not the place for that, but it's giving you a metaphorical meaning of the ayah. Many times if we go in a specific direction, a specific madhab, a specific masjid, anybody who's not conforming to that, we say they are doomed. The meaning of this ayah is asking us to be open-minded. So what is righteousness? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala negated and nullified the righteousness of the direction which people were imposing. Another point on this is, the point for us to deduce from this ayah, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining to us that the methodology which is used in deen and sharia, the methodologies which are used in deen and sharia, these are ways of fulfilling ibadah. They are not ibadah in itself. Methodologies and approaches, these are principles and usul of how to do things, but they are not a full ibadah in itself. That many times people, you know, Ramadan or Hajj, etc., these debates are there. Many times people get engrossed and lost in the methodologies and the actual ibadah which was required, that gets, you know, leaving lots of room for improvement. The methodology is there. Move on. Allah SWT is saying the Qibla for a period of time was allocated to be Masjid al-Aqsa. We've changed it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate decision maker. Move on. What are you still discussing about, you know, what about this direction, that direction? Move on, we've made a decision, right? And get into the spirit and do your ibadah. And also that begs the question, what are the avenues of good? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains with different clauses. وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ. First clause has the five imaniyat, what we believe in. The basics. Many times we go into the technicalities of things, methodologies and technicalities and ikhtilafat, and we forget the basics. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that righteousness starts with the basics, start with the inner self. So the righteousness is iman. Iman billah, amana billahi, the one who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So iman, our aqeedah and belief and Islamic doctrine. Islamic aqeedah. Is my aqeedah strong? That is something for us to check. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us. My aqeedah, my belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that will translate and propel. Iman billah, wal yawm al-akhir, the hereafter, the last day. Qiyamah, accountability. This life is going to come to an end. Everything is temporary. I'm not going to live here forever. I'm investing in everything. Right now, every minute of my life, every dollar of my account is invested to a long-term thing, long-term investments. Allah SWT is saying, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. It's all going to come to an end. It's really temporary. وَالْكِتَابِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ. And the angels, you know, belief in the ghaib, the angels, they've been given different responsibilities. وَالْكِتَابِ and the book of Allah, or the books of Allah, all of the prior revelations, including the Qur'an. وَالنَّبِيِّينَ and the prophets. Now, a quick point, that why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately start off by mentioning imaniyat? I explained that, right? Religiosity and being good starts with inner self. At the same time, who were the people who were making fun and defining righteousness in this direction or that direction? To the Muslimun, the Yahud and Nasara, right, in the context. The five things which are mentioned as part of our faith, in the five things that need to be strong, these are the exact five things that the Yahud and Nasara corrupted in their belief. Allah, Akhirah, Malaika, Kitab, and Nabiyyin. These five things, Allah SWT is saying, you, O followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while you're also getting engrossed in these debates and discussions and methodologies, make sure that your iman in the five things which they corrupted, make sure you are strong in those things. Otherwise you will be also just spending life arguing and saying this is the only way. They corrupted the iman in Allah, that they added attributes of Allah and to God Almighty, and we know that. The Akhirah, another thing. Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu mentions the وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاءُ. Allah subhanahu saying that they are saying that we are the children of God. We are His beloved. قُلْ فَلِمَ يَعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ. Then say to the Imam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why is He punishing you time and time again because of your sins? بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِمَّنْ خَلَقْ. Rather, you are a creation of His creation, which He has created. يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants maghfirah and forgives whomsoever He wishes, and He punishes whomsoever He wishes. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth, or whatever is between it, not to people. وَإِلَيْهِ الْمَصِيرُ. To Him is the return. So this is one approach mentioned. وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً. When they were belittling the Sahaba because of the change of Qibla, these are those who are saying, you know, we are the beloveds and God will never punish us. But if He does, then it will be just ayyama ma'duda for a few days, and then we're going to be out. So, iman billah, iman in the akhirah, iman in the malaika, even the malaika, the angels of Allah, this concept got corrupted by the people of the past. قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلِ. They became adu and enemies of Jibreel and Mikael alayhi salam, right? The books of Allah wal-kitab, يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمَّ وَاضِعِهِ. They started making tahrif and changed the books. والنبيين, the prophets, what was the corruption of the prophets? They didn't believe in them, and when they wanted to take revenge from them, وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ وَيَقْتُلُونَ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Imran. فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ وَكُفْرِهِمْ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَقَتْلِهِمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ وَقَوْلِهِمْ قُلُوبُنَا غُلْفٍ. These are just references. So, respected brothers and sisters, we started the discussion of the ayah. The ayah started with reminding us of our iman. These are the basic starting points for righteousness. Now, a person who has this inner belief in his core, this has to propel him and her to do the right things. That brings us to clause number two. So iman in the five, now faith into action. Faith into action. وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَبِ الْقُرْبَ وَالْيَتَامَ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ. And this person whose faith is strong, now it translates into other things. He gives his wealth despite and in spite of having tremendous passion and love for it. Right? It's in our inner selves, it's in our fitrah and our nature, inborn characteristic of insan, our disposition, that we have intense love for our wealth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that this person gives of his wealth despite having severe love for it. It's difficult to part from it, but he is charitable. She is charitable. So faith in action from within oneself translates to being a social change. Bringing about a social change in one's environment. The people around me, they need to be okay. The people around me, irrespective of their faith, irrespective of who they are, they need to have their basic necessities taken care of. This is a good righteous mu'min. This is a good righteous believer. This is a proper follower of Muhammad Rasulullah. May Allah make us from them. A person who's bringing about through one's charitable contribution and time and volunteering and giving back to society, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّي, despite having love for all of those things, making time to be a change. Okay, so now who deserves my charitable contributions, my wealth, my time, is none other than Dhawil Qurba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, numerous places in the Quran, always talks of the relatives. Here when he talked of charitable contribution, he says, and they give wealth, despite his love, in spite of his love, to the relatives. Dhawil Qurba. Qurba is the plural of qareeb, somebody who is near and dear. An unfortunate reality of our times, every home, every family has this problem. And that is that we are not in good relations with our relatives. Every family. And surprisingly, one of the most exhorted ahkam in the Quran and Sunnah is being good to one's relatives. Rahim, right? The word of relationships, relatives, comes from the root of rahmah. That the word even is reminding us to have compassion and softness when it comes to dealing with our family members. How many of us in our circles, our relatives, uncles and aunts, or second uncles and second aunts, and cousins and first cousins and second cousins, how many of them in our families we haven't talked to and reached out to in years? Months and months, years and years. We are going to be asked about it. We came to the United States, first generation, second or third, and we made it to the top. We have everything at our disposal. We are living the dream, but we're giving them the nightmare. We're living the dream, and we say, everybody, no, just, you're okay over there. Where's your family? Oh, they're there, and they're okay. How do we know they're okay? Have we reached out? Have we even sent a greeting? This is something for us to think about. And I'm reminding myself. So, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِ الْقُرْبَىٰ. So Rasulullah has mentioned to us in many ahadith that even when you give something, you share from it, you share to somebody. الصَّدَقَةُ عَلَىٰ الْمِسْكِينِ صَدَقَةٌ وَعَلَىٰ ذِي الرَّحِمِ ثِنْتَانٌ صَدَقَةٌ وَصِلَةٌ. If you give your charity or something good to make a change in somebody's life to a person in need, that's very good. But if you're giving that to your relative, you get double the reward. One for the charity and one for maintaining that relationship. And even though someone has wronged us, even though somebody has wronged us in our relationship, in our relatives, if I go the extra yard, the extra mile, to show them my good akhlaq and character by sharing and giving and giving gifts to them, softening their hearts. If we are encouraged to do this to people who are not of our relatives and relations, then imagine those who are our relatives, how much it would count, the reward, the perseverance in trying to make a change in their life or trying to get connected to them. These are very, very important things. And the point which I'm trying to allude to here is the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, that, you know, in our life around us, the causes and effects of things, cause and effect, these are from the natural creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cause and effect. But the amazing thing in our faith is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, I need your attention on this point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created a unique connection between the metaphysical things and the spiritual things. There's a connection between the metaphysical and the spiritual well-being. How? I'll give you an example. This hadith, the two things every human being desires naturally. Two things every insan desires naturally. What are they? To live a long life. A long life. Everybody wants to live long. And a life of prosperity. So abundance of provision, risk, right? Excessive amounts of risk and abundance and wealth, and having this life of a long duration. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam promised these two things, and he says, "Man ahabba sallallahu alaihi wasallam, man ahabba an yubsata lahu fi rizqihi wa yunsa'a lahu fi atharihi falyasil rahimah." Whomsoever wants that there should be extra barakah in his and her provisions, and at the same time that وَيُنْسَأَ لَهُ فِي أَثَرِهِ, and there should be extension in his life and her life. So barakah in abundance and long life, he needs to do one thing, فَلْيَصِلْ رَحِمَهُ, then he and she should join ties with those who Allah has placed as their relatives. You see the connection? Allah knows best. This is from the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is the example I wanted to give you, cause and effect, the metaphysical and spiritual. This is a reality. It's our iman. That my life will get better if I do good to my relatives. I'll have more barakah in my life. So وَآتِ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ, back to the ayah. ذَوِ الْقُرْبَىٰ. Always make sure that our relatives are first. We all become so charitable sometimes. We give thousands to, you know, social causes and organizations and people who are doing good stuff. But we forget people who are in our relatives. So ذَوِ الْقُرْبَىٰ. Number two, وَالْيَتَامَىٰ, the orphans. Making a change in a poor child's life. وَالْيَتَامَىٰ. وَالْمَسَاكِينَ, and the poor people, meaning those who don't have the basic necessities. These words are not talking of specifically Muslimun over here. Masakin refers to those who are muhtaj, those in our society around us who do not have the basic needs taken care of. It's my responsibility as a Muslim to make a change in that person's life. You know, many times we say we are in Northern California, mashallah, from the most prosperous communities in the United States. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. So many times you say, you know, we don't know where to give our wealth because we've confined the idea of zakah. Yes, zakah has its stringent technical definition, which is confined to certain mustahiqoon, But the sadaqah is open. So many times we say we don't know who to give sadaqah to, but we don't open our heart and mind and our eyes around us. You see a person holding a sign and saying, I'm a veteran and I'm homeless, that's a shame in itself. A person who is a veteran, we know how veterans are taken care of. So if a person is saying that, and he's standing there with the board, and we say we don't know who to give sadaqah, that is an avenue of sadaqah. We make do something that is rewarding. So anyways, wal masakin, those who do not have the basic needs and necessities. Wabna sabil, and the traveler, a person who's traveling away from their home, if they happen to be in our locality and they are in need, this is a place for sadaqah, make a change. You know, I'm from Folsom, so many students are studying, or many people have came and they are studying in different, or finished their studies and they have started working. So these young immigrants who have left and came and finished their studies here and they're starting off from scratch. We, as a second generation, we've seen that life, we've studied, now we are working and we are successful. Those are the people who need our time also. You know, just in our circles, our friends, our families, we entertain them, we feed our friends all the time. But those who are living like five, six people, you know, roommates together, starting life from scratch, you know, struggling in this world, I've seen so many people like that. And then I look at the social functions, we see the same people are socializing all the time. And those people are alone on Eid, they're alone in Ramadan, they're alone all the time. So we should not forget our roots, how we started off. We should make time for them, right? Make a meal for them, or invite them over, or go and sit with them. This is just an example I'm just sharing. Anyways, وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ, the traveler. وَسَائِلِينَ, and those who come to your doorstep and ask you. So far, if somebody didn't ask, okay, open our eyes and see. But the sa'il, the one who comes and asks, now we have no excuse left to say, I don't know. Allah SWT is saying, if he asks, then fulfill that need. Either, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. If the orphan stands in front of you, and he is putting his hands in front of you, then don't oppress and push away. And the person who's asking, the petitioner, then don't repel, don't be rude. Either you give or you respectfully, I don't have. وَفِي الرِّقَابِ, and those who are in bondage, in his slaves, etc. Now the ayah moves on. وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ, and the righteousness carries on with the person who establishes his and her salah, prayer. This is righteousness. And salah establishment is different from praying one salah. How? If I just pray my salah, that's me worrying about myself. If I'm establishing salah, that's me worrying about my surrounding. That's me making sure that my family and friends, wherever we are, we make sure that salah is being established. That's the difference. In the Quran, usually we don't find yusallun, yusallun. We find yuqimuna salah, iqamatu salah, establishment of salah. وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Allah SWT says to Rasulullah SAW, Surah Taha, 16 juz, and enjoin salah, O Prophet of Allah, upon your family. Make sure, وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا, and be steadfast on it. So back to the ayah, وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ, and he gives zakah. We just spoke of six categories of people who deserve our wealth. So who was that? Sadaqah. Zakah has been mentioned separately. Yes, they can also be the recipients of one zakah. Now, respected brothers and sisters, we're talking about righteousness and the definitions and the clauses. Now, is that sufficient for a person to be a man of good and a woman of good? Allah SWT says no. This is not sufficient. These clauses and points of faith as such, articles of faith, that they have to propel this individual. They have to propel this individual to deal with people in the right way. If his and her mu'amalat and interactions with people are in accordance to the Quran and Sunnah, then this person is righteous. Whether a person is in the masjid five times a day, or has a specific length of one's beard, or specific way of libas and dressing, but then when you deal with that person, you interact with that individual, they say, you know what, don't deal with people who are religious. do a business deal with anybody else, but not that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَهَدُوا. This translates to your interactions. These people of righteousness are those who fulfill their promises and words and contractual obligations and financial commitments. إِذَا عَهَدُوا, when they give their word and their promise. If that person is promising and outwardly you see them, mashallah, so charitable and also very muttaqi outwardly, but they don't fulfill their transaction, they break their promises, this is the whole package. The package is all of these things. If one of them are missing, that's an incomplete faith. وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَهَدُوا. Surah Al-Ma'idah, the first ayah, what does it say? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. From the last ayah, last surah in the Quran, which has halal and haram in it, is Surah Al-Ma'idah. And how the surah starts? O believers, fulfill your promises, your contracts, your financial obligations, whatever word you've given, your promise, your covenant, fulfill it. وَأَوْفُوا بِالْعَهْدِ, Surah Al-Isra, 15 juz. وَأَوْفُوا بِالْعَهْدِ, and fulfill your commitments. إِنَّ الْعَهْدَ كَانَ مَسْؤُولًا. The commitments are such, if you're given your word for it, Allah SWT is saying, you're going to be asked and questioned about it. And while we're on this point of commitments and obligations and fulfillment, respected brothers and sisters, in the hadith, Rasulullah SWT has mentioned, in a very famous hadith, كُلُّكُمْ رَعِنْ كُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ رَعِيَّتِ, right? Famous hadith, each one of you is a shepherd, each one will be asked about his flock. The man of the house is responsible of his shepherd, of his flock, he'll be asked about what goes on in his house. The woman of the house, she will be asked about her flock. That hadith. وَالْإِمَامُ رَعِينَ, and the imam and the leader of the people, he's going to be asked about his flock, he's a shepherd. In that hadith, these three things are quoted always. MashaAllah, we know that. But one portion of the hadith also says, وَالْخَادِمُ رَاعٍ وَمَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ وَفِي مَالِ سَيِّدِهِ. That the khadim, the worker, is also a shepherd and will be asked about his flock. Now, you know, when we say khadim in this word means, oh, the old days, there used to be a slave in bondage, you know, they're working, and Rasulullah is talking about that slave in bondage. No. Rasulullah's words are jawami al-kalim. His words are till qiyamah, they have a meaning. This hadith is reminding us that a khadim means you and I. We are all khuddam. We are all employees of somebody. The khadim over here refers to any Muslim person who is under a contractual obligation working for a firm, for a company, for an entity as an employee. He is responsible and she is responsible for the well-being of his and her master. Master doesn't mean over here bondage. Master means here this, the manager, the person who's running the firm, the company. So what does this tell us? It tells us that Rasulullah SAW is reminding us as employees also to care for the well-being of our companies. The company we work for, or whichever organization we work for, because the Rasulullah said, this worker is going to be asked about the wealth and the ownership of his owner. So if I am a Muslim worker, employee, people should look at me, my interactions, my statements in meetings and my presence, coming and going from and to work. People should look at me and say, this person is a good employee. This guy, she and him, he, they give their best because they are Muslims. Islam is teaching them that. This person is the, you know, comes before time and leaves after. Because the faith says, you know, Muslims are different when they come to work. They give the best. And they make sure that everything is of the best quality. Shouldn't be the other way, na'uzubillah. This person is the last one in and first one out and is lazy. And none of us are like that. But people will label our faith based on how we deal with them. That's so important in today's time. So back to the ayah, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَهَدُوا. They fulfill their contractual obligations and their financial dealings. They make sure everything is intact. وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ. And they are people of sabr. They have sabr in بَأْسَاءَ وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ. In poverty, if things are not going financially in a productive manner in my life, I'm feeling the pinch and I'm struggling, sabr in that moment is very, very fruitful. Allah is reminding us, sabr in difficulty, وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ, any adversity, وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ, and in battle. So these definitions of righteousness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes the ayah by saying, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا. These are those people who are true. They are true to their faith. They are true in their quest of being righteous. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. And they are the people of taqwa and piety. I concluded this ayah. This was ayah 177 in Surah Al-Baqarah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who are righteous in every sense of the word, and those who are practical embodiments of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and these ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ameen. Ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa akhir da'wana hamdu Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa al-aqibatil muttaqeen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulullah Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd, few points which were mentioned with regards to being charitable. The metaphysical and spiritual connection is there in sadaqah also. Three things I would like to share with you. When we give, one hadith mentions Rasulullah said, As-sadaqatu tadfa'u al-bala'. When you preemptively give things to people, it removes adversity and difficulties which might have came our way. Some musibat, some taklif, some difficulty might have came, but me being charitable, it will remove inshallah that. Second one, as-sadaqatu tutfi'u ghadab al-rabb. Sadaqah and sharing from one's wealth removes the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, when the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being charitable removes that, removes the anger. The third one, دَابُوا مَرْضَاكُمْ بِالصَّدَقَةِ. Treat your ill, treat your sick with charity. If somebody is sick in our circles, in our homes, we try all of the necessary precaution and all of the necessary procedures, but don't forget to give sadaqah on their behalf. When you give sadaqah on behalf of somebody who is going through an illness, inshallah the sadaqah will be a form of healing and shifa some way or the other. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعدكم لعلكم تذكرون واذكروا الله العلي العظيم يذكركم ودعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.